Are we back?
We are back. And I'm here with Dr. Tracy Cadell from Eastern Schools. Good morning, Tracy. It's good to see you, sir.
Good morning.
Let's go into politics right away. I know that you have always been involved heavily in the legislative end of education. I know that you had a pretty close connection with Dr. Tony Bennett when he was the superintendent of public education. And there are currently some bills in the State House that have caught your eye. Would that be fair to say?
That would be fair to say.
All right, well, let's talk a little bit about the voucher bill. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Let's get a rundown of the bill and why you do or do not like it.
Well, again, the voucher bill is going to allow parents to use that voucher to take their child to a private school. And the problem with the voucher bill is, well, let me give you a little bit of background. When the voucher bill passed, the argument was that it was actually going to save the state some money. And that the voucher at the time, I believe, is $4,500, and most of the ADM or the school funding across the state is higher than that. For example, Eastern gets about $5,500 per child. Wow. And so the thought was, well, if a family took a voucher, and I'll use Eastern for example, and they found a private school, the state would save $1,000. And so, you know, that at the time was to save the state some money. Now they're talking about expanding the voucher bill, and not only expanding it, but allowing parents to choose to go to private schools without going to the public school first, as well as expanding it to $6,500. Well, that would be even more than what the public schools, a lot of public schools, are getting right. for funding. I know Northwestern doesn't get that. Eastern doesn't get that. I don't think Western. So that argument that had been used to sell the idea of vouchers no longer applies.
Right. Now they're actively campaigning to bring students away from the public school system. I have a fundamental problem with that. I think that school is a choice. If you want to go to public school, I'm assuming you have the resources to do so, because at least in Howard County, we have five very good schools that put out superior products. We have great kids coming out of there. They're all well-educated. Most of them are going on to some sort of post-secondary education, so I don't understand why they would want to push with legislation like this away from you.
I totally agree. And then you add on top of that, along with the voucher bill, they're talking about a $3,000 tax credit to those families for each child, which, you know, our particular parents are all paying textbook fees.
Right.
And, you know, there's no relief being given to public school parents. So I think there's a lot of issues with the voucher bill.
Have you been able to figure out how far along in the process is it? Does it have a lot of support? Is it still in committee?
It is. I think it's going to pass out of the House. I don't think there's any doubt that it's going to pass out of the House. The Senate may stop the bill. Senator Luke Kinley has stated that he's not supportive, and he's a pretty powerful
right.
individual. And so I think there'll be some pushback at the Senate, but you know, the Republicans have a supermajority in both houses, so it may end up passing.
Okay. Now, there's a second piece of legislation that I believe Mike Karakoff is involved in mm-hmm. here. Tell me a little bit about that legislation and where you stand on it.
Well, Mike is he's a loyal public servant here in Howard County, and I certainly respect Representative Karakoff. On this particular issue, we do have some disagreement. Representative Karakoff is pushing a bill, and it did get support out of committee, and we'll be going to the House for a vote, which would create a lottery system for students who would like to transfer within Howard County. No longer could school districts set criteria for acceptance, with the exception of, and I got to give Mike a lot of credit for this, students who had been suspended for 10 or more days or had been suspended for drugs, alcohol, or some type of battery, you know, violence sort of situation, they would not be eligible to transfer, or at least districts could deny them.
Sure.
And but any other student, it would be a lottery system. The problem with that bill from Eastern's perspective, and I don't want to speak for the other county schools, is really at the high school level. At the high school level, there's no provision to protect schools from students attending, I'll take Eastern again for example, who have significant attendance problems or who come to Eastern as a junior or senior with only 3 or 4 or 5 credits. And so if we accepted those students, those students would then count against our graduation rate. And so that's a real issue for us, because we only graduate between 100 and 110 kids. So if you would have 4 or 5 of those students mm-hmm. who would come to your school district, and you could not, no matter what you do, do everything you can to get them graduated on right. time, you're going to be dinged for that in your graduation rate.
What's the penalty there if you have a lowered graduation rate?
Well, ultimately, it's right now it could affect your letter grade. Now, they're talking about changing that A through F letter grade, but now they're also talking about tying funding to those grades. So that is very problematic, particularly at the high school level. What was scary to Eastern, and I was down there yesterday, as well as I had sent some administrators the day before, is there was actually an amendment posed by Bob Boehning, which didn't come up for a vote. It was pulled right at the last minute after a lot of lobbying, that would have denied Eastern the ability to transport kids. You know, currently, we send 2 buses into Kokomo to pick up... right now it's 100 kids, and bring them back to Eastern. And we did that because when this whole school choice movement went into place, we had a number of parents calling us, free and reduced lunch kids primarily, who said, we can't afford to bring our kids to Eastern. Mm-hmm. So we said, we'll come get you. And there was an amendment which was going to stop that, and that would have been devastating to the school corporation. We would have been looking at anywhere from $250,000 to $500,000 and funding cuts if those parents said we can't come to Eastern any longer. And it really goes against the whole idea of school choice and being open for everyone, because if you're not going to be having it available to our free and reduced lunch kids throughout the county, mm-hmm. then why are we doing it? And I know Mike has good intentions, or Representative Karakoff, but I think this is a poster child for success in school choice in Indiana. We have over 700 kids in Howard County who have opted under the school choice program, and it is working. And I know the urban schools, including Kokomo, have made the argument of cherry picking, and that mm-hmm. kids come and then after the ADM they get sent back. That's not occurring in Howard County. I can't speak for Anderson, I can't speak for Marion, and other Fort Wayne, other districts, urban districts, Muncie across the state, but that is not occurring in Howard County.
And that's because you have a good relationship among the superintendents of the schools.
That's correct, yes. Absolutely.
All right, we need to take a little bit of a break. We'll come back, we'll talk a little bit more with Dr. Tracy Cadell. Okay, we are back with Dr. Tracy Cadell in our last segment. We want to talk about a few things that are going on at the school that are really great. I understand that just this week they've announced a Comets Closet, which helps out some of the more underprivileged or disadvantaged kids in your school system. Tell me a little bit about that program.
Well, I tell you what, I was just so proud of our cafeteria and a couple members of our custodial staff. They went to Keith Ritchie, high school principal, and said they wanted to start a closet and collect items for kids, because they had noticed when kids were coming through the lunch line and so forth, they had some needs. And I was just floored by that. And I was just so proud of them. And so they began a comic closet mm-hmm. and have a room this size that we're in today. And I know you may not be able to see that, but a huge room. And
this is not a huge room. He has a bigger room than this.
But it's just full of jeans and coats and caps and all the things that kids might need. Shoes in some cases. We had a young man come in looking for a size 10 gym shoe, and we were able to meet his need. And so it's just been a real blessing to our community. And the high school is accepting donations, and kids are starting to use the closet. So it's been fabulous. And kudos to our staff who saw the need and took the initiative.
Sure.
And so it was certainly a bottom-up approach, not top-down. They saw it and came forward.
Now, how do people go about donating items to the closet, and what kind of items are you really in need of right now?
Right now would be the winter-type items, the hats, the gloves, the scarves, and so forth. And You know, those sorts of things. But the way to would be the way to contact would be call the high school office, 628-3333.
Great. So that's a really good thing going on. Then earlier this year, at the beginning of the school year, I did a little coverage with you on your one-to-one technology program, which was really remarkable. I was amazed at what I was seeing at the middle school level. Everyone had an iPad. The teachers were really involved in it. I remember one social studies teacher that was actually putting the entire lesson online and used a QR code for the kids to scan as they walked in the door to get the lesson plan there. Just really amazing stuff. I was excited about that. How is that going now that you're halfway through this first year?
Oh, it is going very, very well. Every student in grades K through 9 has an iPad, and next year we will be rolling that out K through 12. We are getting state and national recognition for that program. We've presented at the National Model Schools Conference in Orlando, Florida. We've had teachers from Miami, Florida visit us, schools from Ohio, all over Indiana. And our kids and teachers are just doing some amazing things. And I would invite anybody to come out and see what we're doing. To see a kindergartner do a keynote presentation, and you know, and using QR codes to get homework, and as you mentioned, and just learning how to communicate with 21st century devices, it's a really cool thing.
Now, you and I, we're more 20th century type guys. Have you had the chance to work with the hardware and the software there in the one-to-one technology yourself?
Oh yeah, I'm pretty I'm okay at using an iPad, and of course the corporation also has a Facebook account, and I'm actually the administrator for the Facebook account, as well as a Twitter. And we're actually getting ready to roll out in the next month a common app that you'll be able to go to the App Store, as well as have an Android platform and follow Eastern through the app. You know, get the lunch menu, check on your child's grades,
sports
scores,
yeah.
Absolutely. So I think that's going to be a cool thing. You'll be able to carry the Comets in your pocket.
Well, yeah, the entire school on one little device. That's really cool. You know, we ought to have, I think, yeah, actually, we do have an app kind of like that, too. In fact, we've shown some sports on our app. We do some live broadcasting. We haven't done Eastern yet, but, man, we are missing out on some great basketball in Eastern country right now. The girls' basketball team won the sectional first time in more than a decade,
yes,
I believe.
Yes, 1999.
And now you're headed for a one-game regional this Saturday, right?
Well, actually, the regional now is two games.
Oh, it's two games.
It is two games. And so we're very, very excited. It's a great time to be a Comet, and I think we'll do well.
Now, you've got, I believe, two girls on there, the Neely twins, that are 1,000-point scorers. That's great. And they get a lot of attention, and rightly so, because they're great players. They could be all-stars. But how about those other girls on the team? Do you know any of them? You know, what do you think of the rest of the team there?
Well, I don't, you know, being at the central office, I don't know very many of the girls personally, but I can tell you that they're all hard workers. They all are dedicated to the team concept. I mean, when you go watch the Comets play, we have no selfish players, and our quickness it's incredible. We are very, very fast, and I think we're going to give. I think we play Winchester on Saturday, and I think we're going to make the Comet Nation proud.
Great. So, do you have some hopes that you'll be hanging a banner then at the end of the year?
I hope so. I mean, you always start the season and hope that you're going to end up hanging that banner. But regardless, it's been a fabulous season for the Lady Comets.
Absolutely. Congratulations to the Lady Comets. Yeah. And congratulations to Eastern Howard for a great year so far. I hope it finishes up great. And thanks so much for coming on the show today.
Well, thank you.
Dr.
I really appreciate the opportunity.
Not a problem. We're going to go to another break, and then I think we're going to wrap it up.